Greetings. My name is Peter Karagiannis, and I work at the Center for iPS Cell Research and Application, or as you may know it better as CiRA. In this video, I will give an introduction about the special exhibition at the Kyoto University Museum entitled The Journey of iPS Cell Research, The World of CiRA. This special exhibition marks the 10th anniversary of our institute. I hope to convince you that a remarkable amount of groundbreaking science has happened at CiRA over these 10 years. This slide provides an outline of the exhibit that can still be visited by a limited number of people. Our purpose is to not only describe CiRA research, but also to provide some basic facts about the institute and an impression of being a researcher, which is why we designed a research environment in the top where visitors can see the type of equipment used at our institute. In the prologue section on the right, we give attention to the decades of science that led to the discovery of iPS cells. And that's where I want to begin. iPS cells is short for induced pluripotent stem cells. They are adult cells that have been reprogrammed to the embryonic state. iPS cells have two distinctive features. First, they can multiply indefinitely, meaning one iPS cell can become many iPS cells. Second, they can be differentiated into any cell type, meaning an iPS cell can be converted into a brain cell, a heart cell, or another type of cell. Here is an image of an iPS cell colony. The circular shape you see is not of one iPS cell, but of many iPS cells. In fact, each little speckle inside the colony represents an iPS cell. Around the colony are fibroblasts that fail to reprogram into iPS cells. Yes, iPS cell reprogramming has a high failure rate, something researchers are trying to improve. As is obvious by this photograph, one of the effects of reprogramming is changing the cell morphology, as the iPS cells in the middle were once fibroblasts, like those surrounding the periphery. I want to add that iPS cells are not found in the body, they are artificially produced. However, iPS cells are made from cells in the body, normally easy to access cells like skin or blood cells in which we activate certain genes or other factors to initiate the reprogramming process. For unknown reasons, some cells respond to the activation and others do not, which is why we see a mix of iPS cells and fibroblasts in the photo. The ability of iPS cells to multiply and to differentiate into a wide range of cell types makes them similar in nature to the fertilized egg. But they are not the same as a fertilized egg because iPS cells cannot make a whole human body. Finally, because of their two major features, multiplication and differentiation, iPS cells have many potential clinical applications. Examples include cell transplantation and drug discovery. But before that, I want to review the science that led to the discovery of iPS cells. This chart summarizes those breakthroughs. iPS cells are just one type of stem cell. The first were discovered by McCullough and Till in 1961. Perhaps the most important finding came a year later in 1962 with John Gurdon's famous tadpole experiments. Gurdon showed that by putting the nucleus of a gut cell from an adult frog into a frog egg, one could grow a full frog that had the same genes as the gut cell. In other words, a clone. The important point of this discovery was that it showed the nucleus of an adult cell has all the information needed to make a full body. Most scientists at the time thought that the cell could not change into another cell type once its role had been fixed. That is, a cell would purge itself of unneeded DNA, so a heart cell would not have DNA for brain cells, and bone cells would not have DNA for blood cells. But the frog experiment demonstrated this idea to be mistaken. It showed that the cell from the frog's gut still contained the genes necessary to generate a whole frog body, and that these genes can be artificially reactivated. This discovery formed the foundation of subsequent iPS cell research because it suggested the possibility of turning on genes in adult cells that would reprogram the cell to an embryonic state. Other key discoveries include mouse embryonic stem cells in 1981, Dolly the sheep in 1987, which proved Gurdon's experiments applied to mammals, and human embryonic stem cells in 1998. Finally, in 2006, Shinya Yamanaka and colleagues succeeded in creating iPS cells from mouse cells, and in 2007, from human cells. With that discovery, the Center for iPS Cell Research and Application was established in 2008. It then became an independent institute in 2010 to accelerate the clinical application of iPS cells. In 2012, CiRA director Shinya Yamanaka was awarded the Nobel Prize, which he shared with John Gurdon, for the discovery that mature cells can be reprogrammed to become pluripotent. That marks nearly half a century between discoveries made by the winners. It was also an unprecedentedly short time for discovery to receive the award. Another key moment came in 2015. For iPS cells to be applied to medicine, there has to be a reliable supply of cells that are safe to use. CiRA therefore started the iPS Cell Stock Project. The cells created under this project are supplied to research organizations and other institutes investigating new therapies. Regarding clinical trials, in 2017, using patient iPS cells, CiRA scientists identified a drug candidate to treat fibrodysplasia ossificans progressiva, a disease in which bone starts to form inside muscle tissue. A clinical trial is now ongoing at Kyoto University Hospital. In 2018, CiRA launched its first clinical trial of regenerative medicine. Parkinson's disease is caused by the death of dopaminergic neurons. In this trial, cells prepared from iPS cells from the stalk are transplanted into patients' brains to replace the lost neurons. Back to the Nobel Prize, it was, as you can imagine, a memorable time for CiRA. Still, the feeling at CiRA was that it was too soon to be receiving the prize since there was still no clinical research, let alone clinical application of iPS cells. Having said that, after our name started appearing on the candidate list, we were always anxious with anticipation every October when the announcement is made. In 2012, the day of the announcement was a public holiday in Japan. We came to work anyways, just in case. Starting from the moment of the announcement, we were overwhelmed with requests from the media. We also received many congratulatory bouquets from many people, making our entrance resemble something more appropriate for a wedding than a research institute. After the award, with all the press conferences, media coverage, and invitations to give lectures and contribute articles, Professor Yamanaka was exhausted. This chart provides some basic data about CiRA, but we are going to focus on the right column. At the time of our establishment in 2010, our staff was just 178 people, but as of 2019, we were 539 people. It might surprise you to learn that only half our staff are devoted to research. The others are support staff and contribute to activities like equipment management, patent acquisition, and fundraising. Here, I want to return to the clinical application of iPS cells. This image shows the work on Parkinson's disease and fibrodysplasia ossificans progressiva described earlier. You can see both began in 2010, but the clinical trials did not start until 2018 and 2017, which actually is a short period of time. Let's focus on the Parkinson's project. The many steps along the way to Parkinson's clinical trial included research that wasn't even focused on the disease. Instead, from 2010 to 2014, important work on the safety of iPS cells was done. In addition, animal experiments testing the safety of the brain cells was done in 2017. Truth is, this project would have taken even longer had there already not been 10 years of preceding research done with embryonic stem cells, which have similar properties to iPS cells. This takes us to the end of our exhibition. I hope you have gained some insight and appreciation on CiRA's 10-year journey and the history of iPS cell research. As you have seen, CiRA depends on support not only from researchers, but also patients, donors, and people like you. What you see here is a display on which we had originally intended to gather comments from visitors at the exhibition venue. People would have been asked to write their hopes and expectations of CiRA. But due to the new format of the exhibition made necessary by the coronavirus pandemic, this is no longer practical. Nevertheless, we still very much want to hear your thoughts and have you share your comments online about your vision for CiRA. After watching this video, we therefore ask you please stay on the page and leave your comments at the link marked Online Contact for Shaping the Future Together. Thank you for your attention.